in the Northern Territory, the Aboriginal vote proved to be a major factor in the election of the country Liberal Party. Among the talking points before the election were the need for more consultation with communities and a push for greater self-determination. Alan Clark investigates the call for a Yolngu Nations Assembly.
A lush island paradise off the northern coast of Arnhem Land. For Yiricha, like Jane Gurachu, this is home. But beneath the serene beauty of Elko Island lies an undergrowth of discontent.
We should be running our own community because we belong to the land. This is our land. We are connected to the land and sea.
A member of the Galpa clan, Jane was born in a cave and educated under the missionary system. She's seen a lot of changes in her lifetime, but nothing as dramatic as the current Commonwealth government policies.
We're expecting something from the government to release us and not use us as a puppet on a string for all those years. Coming here and promises are not being kept.
But what was once just a smouldering ember of discontent is now a volatile blaze of frustration.
They think that we are stupid. The government don't see us that we are a human being with brain. We are smart. Our brains are better than Balanda.
Save money.
The kind of resentment that, here in Arnhem Land, has ignited a political response. Jane is part of the Yolngu Makaduni. Translated, it means the Yolngu Nations Assembly, a grassroots body calling for an independent Yolngu government, which would represent their communities and influence legislation throughout the vast Arnhem region. This assembly, which has grown to represent over 2,000 people, was born out of opposition to the federal government's Stronger Futures legislation.
There's no respect in this country for the First Nation. No respect, you know? Yeah. And they know that the nation, the biggest council in the world, have criticized and against this particular bill. So they just went ahead and did it.
We are launching today the discussion paper. It's called Stronger Futures in the Northern Territory.
Stronger Futures is what Labor calls its version of the anti-intervention. It will be in place for the next 10 years. But prior to the legislation being passed in the federal parliament, the Yolngu Nations Assembly sent a strongly worded letter of protest to Canberra. It included a call for the Stronger Futures legislation to be thrown out of federal parliament and a threat to obstruct lucrative new mining developments. But it's had little impact.
When that bill was passed in Senate, I and many of our leaders said, you know, we're not going to stop fighting. We'll continue to fight. We'll continue to fight and we will challenge it until the Prime Minister and her government need to understand that this bill has got nothing to do with Aboriginal people. It's confusing Aboriginal people, it's control Aboriginal people, it's a racist bill. The law must be scrapped.
A spirit of defiance, fueled by government suspicion of the Assembly and claims that the police have conducted surveillance of its members.
This is basic hysteria that develops from non-Indigenous people. As soon as Indigenous people start to rise up and do something for themselves, and in this situation the same thing developed where because there was no government organisation like mainstream government organisations, because there was no service providers involved, because there was no GBM or Shire manager or any of these people included in the process because they had no business in being involved, there was a fear of black uprising, I guess, and to the point that we had a policeman come in and take pictures.
Last month's NT election result reflected the growing dissatisfaction against Labor after the country Liberal Party swept to power, ending 11 years of Labor rule in the territory. Swirling across Arnhem Land, a new wind of change, demanding more say in the way policies are implemented.
The reality is there's already a government here. It's just not acknowledged. And the longer we go on without acknowledgement, the more resistance that gets developed to the mainstream, the more the further disenfranchisement continues, the further we get into an unsavable social situation.
But this situation isn't unique to Australia. On the other side of the Pacific Ocean, Indigenous people have provided inspiration for the Yolngu model. In Canada, the Assembly of First Nations is made up of community leaders with a charter to protect Canadian Indigenous rights. Recognised by the United Nations, its success is varied, but it's had victories in altering legislation. It's a world away from Jane's homeland, but she insists that the Yolngu uprising will continue until she can see a brighter future for her children and grandchildren.
We are wise. We have plans for our kids. But government is the father and mother. They always knock down, or they want to do a better way to satisfy Indigenous people in remote communities without asking what's your goal? What's your dream or vision for particular community or homeland?
Only time will tell whether the Yolngu Nation's Assembly has what it takes to become a powerful player in Aboriginal affairs. Until then, one thing remains, their passion.
And that was the first of a three-part series on social issues confronting the NT. Next week, Alan Clark investigates what the future holds for Aboriginal homelands in the Territory in this time of political change. Still to come on Living Black, climate change, how it could impact on Aboriginal communities.